it will be forever. Or I'll never fall in love. In a restless world like this is, love is ended before it's begun. And too many moonlight kisses seem to cool in the warmth of the
Hi,
sun.
Hi, I'm John Solari, your host of The Method Actor Speaks. Where each week we come to you and we talk to you about the work. And today we have a special guest, and I am so grateful that John Polito is here today. And before we go a little further, I want to just acknowledge that you're really a gift as an actor that you've been given to us.
Thank you. Thank
no, no,
you.
No. I want people, you're such a talent. I mean, people, they don't know your name, but when they see, oh.
Yeah, yeah.
You're one of those gifted actors that.
Well, it's because I've done just about everything for somebody. Somebody's always seen something that, you know, I've been working a long time, but really since, let's say, the late 80s, I think there's been one thing that has hit each group, age group, and something usually fun came out of that. If you work on a Seinfeld episode that's big, or if you do a kid's movie, or if you do a horror movie, one of those has just, there's been something that's hit people where they always feel that they know me from school, they come up and they want to talk to me. But I think it's, and I also think the kind of, whatever kind of acting thing I've done, even with the show Homicide or stuff, people felt I was approachable because it was sort of like it was never an aloof character I played, more accessible, which has been fortunate for me.
Yeah, it's, Homicide is playing a lot now, and I watch it all the time, but you on it.
Yeah.
So I have to ask you the question, who do you really believe killed Lincoln?
That's an amazing thing, isn't it? You know what's funny about that whole situation? The thing we're talking about is that I became obsessed with the Lincoln assassination because it really was very shaky about who did what and who covered for who. But I always felt, as an actor, that I really was obsessed with the Kennedy assassination. But I could not deal with it. It was too close to me. So I had to go back to other things that were similar. So I was sort of using that. Everything I was talking about was actually covering up for the fact that I really was upset about the Kennedy thing. Because I felt my character would be a real Kennedy guy.
It's funny because I'm the guy behind the Noel.
Oh. And I believe it. I believe it. Oh, you are? In Ruby?
Yeah.
Oh, speaking of Ruby, I just worked with with Danny Aiello in this thing in Boston. Danny's pretty terrific, I have to admit.
Yeah, I'm the guy behind the Noel.
Well, you know, that's a life note about you. I can always say that about Solari. He's the guy behind the knoll.
I tell you, now you know who killed Kennedy.
Exactly, exactly.
Now, let me ask you, why did you become an actor?
My brother used to make movies when I was a kid. Stop motion things and all, King Kong-like things, and actually became a very successful animator and stuff. And I was very interested in watching what film was about from the time I was a kid. And then I saw my sister do a play, Anastasia, when she was in high school. And that is the first time I really saw a live theater thing, and that really turned me on. But mostly it comes from, they used to have these movies, these 4:30 movies that were on when I was a kid. And you come home from school, you do your homework, and there would be these movies. And I really became very obsessed with watching all of these different performances, the old Warner Brothers films and stuff, and getting to know the actors' names and watching the process, and then trying to figure out what the difference between the comic acting was and all. I became really kind of obsessed with watching it and how it worked out. And I was very fortunate what happened to me because I was in a high school, West Catholic in Philadelphia, the West Catholic High School, and this Christian brother, Dominic Garvey, comes in, and he's taking courses up at Villanova University, which is a mainline pretty above me kind of university for the class that we were in. But he was taking a graduate course, so he came back to the high school, and he changed one of our science labs into a theater, a black box theater. And he brought all the writers and the graduate students down to our high school to direct the students in their projects. Well, at that time was David Rabe, incredible playwright, Leslie Lee, a wonderful black playwright, amazing playwrights, amazing, amazing projects were being done with the high school students. And because that university saw my work there, they offered me a scholarship to Villanova, which was way out of my bounds. And that's So the acting thing really came out of a gradual thing of watching movies and then seeing a little bit of theater. And then I had a friend, the same guy, Dominic Garvey, took me to a production of The Little Foxes, Lillian Hellman's play, which was going to Broadway. It was Margaret Leighton and Geraldine Chaplin, a terrific cast, Harris Yulin. And I was there, that was like my first actual professional play, and that got to me as well. Something was happening in my mind about what the difference of the acting was from, I was seeing differences in acting styles. I was seeing the difference between a television show and a movie. I saw Citizen Kane very early on and thought this
What was the difference that you saw? Can I ask you that?
I can't put my finger on it. I knew I wanted to do, initially I only wanted to do the heavy stuff, the stuff like the Orson Welles stuff. I liked big performances, things that I knew were bigger than life, but somehow I could relate to. On television, we had the show The Untouchables. There was an actor, Nehemiah Persoff. One of my favorites. And yes. I remembered his name, even as a kid. That's Nehemiah Persoff, because it was such a great name. I remember seeing Sidney Greenstreet when I was a kid, and remembering his name. These big actors, Charles Laughton,
right.
That stuff. There was something larger than life, but something I could really relate to. And that was something I was attracted to from the time I was a kid.
I always thought Nehemiah should have played Al Capone.
Well, he was Al Capone on Untouchables.
Yeah, but I mean,
but he should have actually done going. Yeah,
and he's still alive. And he's a member of the Actors Studio.
Oh, he is wonderful.
Yeah, Nehemiah, one of my favorite actors.
I of course am not a member of the Actors Studio.
No, but you belong there.
I belong there.
No, I mean, well, that's what I'm talking about. You see, some of the greatest actors. Oh, God, you were talking again. You worked with Brando.
Yeah, no, I was in the Freshman with Brando, and you said Bruno Kirby was on the show. Now, Brando, to me, first of all, he was such an amazing man, looking man, really such charisma. I actually ran into him in an elevator before we shot, and I got onto the elevator and saw this little man. He had a big hat on, and I turned around at the front of the elevator, and I thought, something's like heating me up in the back of my shirt. Who is this guy? And I turned around and saw it was him. He had an actual charisma that there was an aura about him that was actually that physical. I don't think he was great as a person because he was difficult to talk to. He had his privacy and he was going through things at the time. But as an actor, he was totally, it was like working with Hoffman. I did Death of a Salesman with Hoffman, the revival production in 85 with Malkovich and all that. It was the same kind of thing. They joked around all the time. And then when the camera was on, they came on. Brando was very much right there when it came on. But you never quite knew what he was going to do. And he was very generous on the set. Off the set, you couldn't talk to him. But, you know, a lot of actors that you adore are not accessible as people.
Yeah, well, I find most talented actors are accessible.
Well, I can't say, I couldn't just say that, because I would like to believe that. There have been some people that I just adored, and then I met them. And then I thought, you know what? I don't like your acting so much after all. No, but I think you'd like to believe that some, but you know what it is? It's because everybody's process is the same, is different. And so you find that a lot of actors have to go into themselves and do a lot of prep and do a lot of stuff. You meet them as a person, or you're working with them, and they're not really very pleasant to be on a set with. Let's say a film set in particular. Because film sets, unlike the theater thing, that film set thing is, it's instant family. You have to bond right away. You have to find your position within the unit, within the factory of film. And so if there's a sort of a bad egg or someone who I actually said I was interviewed recently, and I said, you know, the first thing I do on a set is I watch where all the PAs, if I see a PA come out of a trailer and he looks really frazzled, watch out for the actor in that trailer, you know, careful, danger.
That's a good line to have. It's something to remember, yeah.
Yeah.
I've seen that too, where the actors would abuse the PAs.
Yeah, and whenever somebody's going for the lower ones, I've seen, I remember, because when I'm working on film, we're talking about, this show is about the methods of work and my
Your method, really.
My method, what had happened, and I've talked about this before, but I've got to get this out. What had happened was I was a very good theater actor, a wonderful theater actor. I got an Obie Award, all this different crap, and I knew that I was working very well in the theater. in front of an audience. But when I did film at first, I just assumed you had to do less and that you had to repeat for each take. So I was like doing technically the same thing all the time. I looked good. I was thin and gorgeous and always looked good. And I kept it as, you know, simple and quiet as it could be. And, you know, what I thought was film acting, and I couldn't stand my work. I looked at my work. Not that I couldn't stand my work, but I would look at my work and I could see myself acting. I didn't see the character. I saw this veneer between me and the character. So I went through this process of what is wrong with this picture of motion pictures for me? And what I figured it out is because it's not theater. And so what I started to do was get to know every crew member, what their names were, who was behind the camera, who was doing this, who was running that, who the prop people were. And I began to, by knowing them, great wardrobe, wait till you see what I'm gonna do with it in this scene, or wonderful, hey, focus puller, you know, I'm gonna be moving up here. Making friends with everyone. And so what I was really doing was handpicking an audience. So when I was performing, I was no longer just performing for a camera where I felt I was just focused on the camera and my acting was camera-wise proper. I was performing for an audience behind the camera, a hand-picked audience. So I had a front row of theater, and I was doing theater in front of the camera. And that's when I began to see my work. I would watch the work and think, hey, that's not me, that's performance. You know, and it was a process for me. That's my method on film, was to actually recreate a theater environment. That's like amazing. Rehearsals, you know, like, right.
I never thought of that.
Well, it's only because also, as I told you before, my brother was around film, and I had my Super 8 camera, my 8mm camera, and all. So I knew where the camera was at all times. I know where, I have a general sense of where the lights are, where the cameras are at all time. So for me, it was working against me as an actor, because I was therefore not focusing here, I was focusing there, where that unit was. So I had to find a process of making me do a theater performance. I think there's a comfort zone, and also because I started in small theater being like a room about the size of a sound stage or the size of this kind of a stage, that you know you can work for a small amount of audience, a three camera system or a three, you know, you find a way of doing theater work in front of film is really what I'm talking about, and that's what I did. Because I think the theater work thing is, you know your stuff and you're doing your stuff, and then something, and you want to have it all proper, and then something hopefully magically happens in the moment between the two people.
Right.
And that accident is the one you want to record. That's the one, that's the rehearsal you want to get on camera. Exactly. You know, and that's the
accident.
I like the accident.
That. That's really a good way of looking at it.
Yeah.
Did you train with anybody in before?
I trained at, first this guy, Dominic Garvey, was very good in terms of really being on top of me as a kid about, okay, you're really good at acting like crying. Now maybe you could really cry in this part. Because I was a pretend actor. I still am sort of a pretend actor, but now the instrument works that I can actually get to the real stuff underneath, or at least it reads that way. I'm never quite sure whether the method is the real thing or it's acting like it's the real thing. You know, sense memory, I was always real questionable about. But, you know, whatever works. And then when I went to Villanova University, there was this wonderful woman who had been in a production of Six Characters in Search of an Author in New York, and a lot of wonderful plays, and she studied with Alan Miller, and her name is Irene Baird, and she was and is an incredible teacher and an incredible woman. She, where I was technical initially, she came in and really shook up the works about, all right, that's bullshit. I mean, she would smoke a cigarette, and she was a fabulous looking woman, a beautiful woman, a very exotic, beautiful woman. Get down to what's really happening. So she was very involved in the process, more involved in the process working on something than getting to the result, less involved in result. Well, for a while I thought, well, you know, I want the result for the performance. What I didn't realize until later was if you keep on working on the process of getting to the result, even as you're performing, you're giving a result, but it's still an exploratory thing that's working very well for the audience out there at that time. And then after studying with her for three or four years, a guy came in who just passed away this year named Paul Bettis, came in as a director, and he was quite the opposite and said, I don't care about your process, give me result.
Really?
Which was a complete opposite thing. He's a British guy. But his thing was, give me a result, an instant result, but let's do it. He did only improvisational stuff. So you'd have a series of rules for a play, and you'd have to go out there and make it up on the spot. So he wanted it all to look good out front, but you were making up on the spot. So it was really a combination of the danger area, the sports area of theater, which is really like, I'm serving it to you, and you're serving it to me, on the moment in front of an audience, along with this other process from Irene Barrett, which was to explore, and then this good stage, strong technical background from this guy, Dominic Garvey. And those three processes lasted with me until I graduated from Villanova, at which point I got a job almost right away in a union theater in Philadelphia, and I just kept on working. I never had another job in all this time. So.
Really? You've been an actor all your life?
I got out and got my cards, got out of Villanova in late 73, and got my cards by 74, my union cards, and I've never had another job. Knock on wood, since I'm 73 years old, and I can lose my job any day.
Yeah, God. I remember you in Crime Story with Tony Bennison. And
Crime Story is a very good thing. There is a guy, a very important guy in the studio and a wonderful actor, Stephen Lang.
Yes, he was in
Stephen Lang. Stephen Lang and I did theater together. Stephen was rough on me. We did this thing I got the Obie Award for. It was a series of plays in 79, 80, and I was in this Brooklyn Academy of Music company. And one of the parts I got as a lead, this lead character, Steve wanted. So Steve would be in my dressing room, because we had the same big dressing rooms, the wonderful theater dressing rooms.
Yes.
You know, you're really stinking this role. You know, you suck in this role. You're never going to be able to do it. Every night was always edging me on. But Steve was very wonderful and loyal to me and very strong supporter of mine. Steve was cast in this show, Crime Story, and knew Michael Mann. Because Steve had done a performance in the original Red Dragon, which was called Manhunter, that Michael Mann had directed. And so Steve got this job, this show, Dennis Farina, and Anthony Dennison was his nemesis, and then there was Steve Lang as this lawyer character. Okay. So Steve told Michael Mann, put Polito on the show, he's a company guy. So I read for a very small character that was only supposed to be on the first two episodes and then get whacked, but I got in it, and Tony Dennison and I got along very well on camera. It was a beautiful relationship. Me as a goomba, supposed to be a tough guy, but really I was a wussy gangster type.
I thought
I was kind of tough, but...
I felt you right on.
Yeah, well, I thought it was... I always thought there's something about my version of a wise guy is never really as cool as the real guys. He wants to be. But I, you know, it's a funny thing, because I remember thinking, this guy's a little weaker, because I knew I had to be killed. I was going to eventually be killed by Tony Dennison. So part of the character thing was, always I found a guy came on, an extra came on. He was this big mother. And I said, every time I want that guy on as my bodyguard all the time, because I always wanted to be dwarfed by this big guy, you know, me being all tough and this big guy behind me, I had the protection of the guy in the back. I felt that support behind me.
Well, if you look at Carlo Gambino, he was a little guy.
Yeah. Well, though, a lot of the big guys were little guys. In stature.
Anthony Francioso played the best wise guy I ever seen in Across 110th Street.
Oh, my God, yes. And God rest that man's soul, too. What a great actor.
He was one of the... never got the recognition. A great actor.
And wait, because we were talking before about the studio and the hat full of rain. One of the things I saw early on, or maybe I think this is late high school, early college, was Hat Full of Rain, which was completely improv at the studio.
Yes, it was. That was developed,
at the studio by Shelley Winters and Ben Gazzara.
Another one of God. Oh, what an actor. Never given the credit.
I saw...
Ben
Gazzara is one of the greatest.
He did Huey. He did, from what I understand, he did the best Huey, Eugene O'Neill's play.
I saw Gazzara and Colleen Dewhurst when they revived
Long Day's Journey Night?
No.
Virginia Woolf.
I think that was the revival. That's when I saw Gazzara on stage.
Well, he also originated the role of Brick.
Brick, I know.
A lot of people think it's Paul Newman in the movie, but it was him. And they developed that at Actors Studio with Tennessee Williams.
Yeah.
I mean, those days are really, that's why people like yourself I want on the show. Because you remember that, and people need to hear and see the work that you do and what you know. Because, I mean, it's a dying art, in a sense, today.
I've been surprised by some of the... Look, I have a lot of great younger actor friends, and I love working with them. But there was a period about 6 years ago when I got together with, there was an actor, I was an actor-musician, and he was acting like crazy, and I was discussing with him certain things. I said, well, it's like talking about, let's say, Jane Fonda in Clute. And the guy said, Jane Fonda, she's nothing. And he had never seen Clute. Mm. It was like there was no, my whole reason, I think, for my respect for acting had to do with this fact that I always was interested in watching the old.
Yeah.
So you begin to watch an actor. I just recently, they asked me to do commentary. They're going to do a documentary. They're releasing this movie All Through the Night, a Bogart film, a studio film, really not a very good film. In this film, aside from Bogart, is William Demarest, and but there's a performance by Jackie C. Gleason. Jackie Gleason, when he was 23 years old, went by Jackie C. Gleason. And he's doing all that tough guy stuff, talking a mile a minute stuff. And I thought, now that's a historical thing that people should see, to see how he went from there and developed his work and his comedy to get to where he did something like The Hustler.
I was going to say, bring it out from there to The Hustler.
From there to The Hustler.
From what I understand, I heard they really didn't want him back in the remake because he's like stole the movie, I heard.
Yeah, right. You know? Well, Newman's, I got to say about Paul Newman.
Not Paul Newman. But
no, I know. You're talking about Gleason.
No, I mean, it wasn't Paul Newman that didn't want him back. It was the other people.
Oh, yeah, from the other
producers.
What about, there are certain actors also that have come, they come into their own later on. They get better and better.
It takes time.
For me, I was a young guy. When I was young and I had been heavy and then I lost all this weight and I was doing all this theater stuff, but for the most part, the roles I was playing that I was best at were the ones where I was characterized and stuffed up and playing fat. When I got fat again, which I really did started doing during Crime Story, because I felt if my character was going to be killed, I wanted to fatten the calf. I actually said to wardrobe, I'm starting in dark colors, but the more we're getting closer to my death, dress me whiter and whiter and whiter. I want to be in light colors for my fatted white calf killing by Tony Denison over in Boston. I was wearing white, eating gravy and bang, you shot man, crawling on the floor. I mean, you know, fatten the calf. And I was thinking that because I started gaining weight in that and then gained more and more weight for different things and actually was just getting fat. But that was very important for me because Miller's Crossing, I would never have gotten Miller's Crossing except for the fact that I was 38 when I got cast because they wanted a 55-year-old role and I had fattened up. So you can't really tell how old I am in Miller's Crossing. Let's change the subject because I'm svelte and gorgeous.
Yeah, you are. You slimmed down. I couldn't, I almost didn't recognize you coming in.
Yeah.
Looks so good.
So good. Let's talk about beauty. No.
Where is she? That's the next show. But I thought you were talking about actors and that I watched Eric Roberts the other night in The L Word. The guy's a good actor.
Oh, terrific actor. Eric Roberts was always a great actor. I was a fan of Eric Roberts forever.
We got about 5 minutes. Anything special you want to talk about? Or?
No, I just want to just talk about what? That I'm happy I'm still here, that we're still working on stuff. I'll talk about one other thing, which I also, about the process of these roles and stuff. I'm never a guy who fights playing the same roles. People have said to me about this thing about being typecast. I don't think it's typecast. I think all characters are either the gangster, the cop, the detective, or I've never been really the father, just the simple father, or the love interest. But those basic roles, sometimes you get the opportunity to repeat those roles and make them better. What we were talking about with Crime Story was that character in Crime Story was my first really sort of gangster character. That character I kept like in my files. I didn't do another character like that until I was 4 or 5 years later and doing Miller's Crossing, which was an extension of that character. And you get a repertoire under your belt and you keep these library of characters that you bring back. And there's this new thing I just did this thing called The Big Nothing. And there was a character in Barton Fink I played, which was a nerdy kind of very... I got a chance to repeat that character. And it's been one of the great gifts to have a library that you're able to go back into and hit the roles again.
Yeah, because you've been in some good films.
I've been very lucky.
Very lucky.
Considering the failures I've been in. And I've been in some movies that didn't make a nickel, but I'm still here.
You're talented. That's, I try to tell people talent prevails.
I'd love to believe that's true.
Well, look at you. You've worked since you began.
Yeah, I guess there must be something that prevailed because I've been in some stinkers and I'm still here.
You still do the work. I've never seen you walk through the work
Yeah, there's something that happens when the camera's on, even if I'm not sure where I am. Something takes over.
I used to watch Richard Lynch, the actor, never walked through. I would watch him on these like
very interesting actor, this Richard Lynch.
Wonderful actor.
Yeah. Actually, are you.
Well, he did the first movie. His first movie was called The Seven Ups.
Oh, yeah, I know.
And I told him, I said, those are the guys that arrested me.
So it's never been acting with you. It was the real thing. Really, now that's a method.
It's a true story.
That's a real method.
They were the guys, they were Bronx Organized Crime Task Force.
Uh-huh.
And he did the movie.
He did the movie of the guys who busted you.
Yes. Well. He was the cops, they were called the Seven Ups. And you got, when they busted you for organized crime, you got 7 years and up. Mm. Then they got busted.
And the list goes on and on. Busting. Let's talk about, real simply to sum it up. So the method about all this is there are so many methods.
And it's your method, whatever works for you.
It's your method. And that's a wonderful thing, because I wasn't sure coming here whether you were specifying.
I try to tell people that their method is what it is. We got 1 minute, so I'm just going to just say this quick. There's three things in life. There's family, making love, and the smell of gravy on a Sunday morning.
If you say gravy,
yes,
baby.
You gotta say. People think that's not the stuff
you
put on mashed
potatoes. That's tomato sauce. You guys say sauce.
We gotta say it's
we
not
say
the mashed
gravy,
potatoes.
It's gravy. It's gravy.
People don't know that.
No, because it's a regional thing. As a matter of fact, in some places in Italy, they still call it sauce. They're not Italians.
They're not Italians. We know in New York, but isn't that a great
and listen,
smell?
That's a life note. There's nothing like the smell of gravy. If you're an actor and you're even a young actor, just remember the smell of gravy. Whatever your gravy is, whether it be brown or red.
That's
remember
right.
The smell of gravy, and you're going to have a smile on your face, and
it's
you'll
true.
Act better.
That's a great line. When I look at it, I never thought of it that, but it's true.
John Polito's big quote about acting, the smell of gravy.
On a Sunday morning.
On a Sunday morning?
As my Uncle Carmine would say, even when you're wrong, we make you right.
Even when you're wrong, we make you right. And that's a good acting note.
Yes, but I want to say, it doesn't cost nothing to be nice, and we're wrapping it up, and thank you, Mr. John
Polito.
God bless you.
Thank you, sir.
No, really.
Yeah,
thank
no,
you.
Real. No, you.
Okay.
All right.
You're a gift, you really are.
Yeah.
That was wonderful.
Good.
I mean, really.
Restless world like this is, love is ended before it's begun.